power as everyone this morning. Let's come and glorify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. That comes from Psalm 34:3. Let's glorify his mighty name and give him the praises and honor that he deserves. Sound the trumpets, for the day of the Lord is upon us. Hallelujah. Lift a shout, a celebration, a praise to the one who is entering in. Make way. Make way. He is entering in. Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. All we have, there's a stirring in the heavens and earth. This is Jesus. He's entering in. Make way, he's entering in. Make way, he's entering in. Hosanna, blessed.
He's entering in. He's entering in. He's entering in.
Hallelujah. You are so worthy, God.
Worthy of it. He's so holy. Hallelujah.
Oh!
him praise. Hallelujah. He's worthy. When you don't have anything else to say, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. And we just thank you, Lord. We praise you. You are so worthy. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. So wonderful and awesome and holy. Jesus.
By the stripes of Jesus, my mind has peace. I claim the stripes of Jesus. Fear has no hold on me. By the stripes of Jesus, I am healed.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
I claim the stripes of Jesus. No matter what I feel, Spirit, come and move, bring heaven to earth. Spirit, come and move, bring heaven to earth. By the stripes of Jesus, all strongholds go. I claim the stripes of Jesus, there's freedom for my soul. Spirit, come and move.
Time to be gathered together to celebrate Jesus for what he did for us with communion. It's a time to remember that he saved us from what he did on that cross, that his body was broken, his blood was poured out. And so we're gonna take a time to just give God honor and praise, because without him we wouldn't be here. Amen. So we thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, that you were on that cross for us, that you poured out your blood for us. Lord, we thank you that you rose again and you are alive. That you sit at the right hand of the Father with all authority in heaven and on earth. We thank you, Jesus. Holy are you, Lord. There is power in your blood, Jesus. If we could have the elders come, please, that are present. Pastor Jim, and then Butch, could you come, please? You want to just... Do you want to look? Yeah. So what we're going to have is these two sections over here. You're going to come down through this aisle. You're going to collect your emblems, and then you're going to go back and seat it. And then these two sections, you'll come down these aisles, collect your emblems. Please wait until everybody has them so that we could partake together. So if you'd please come. We do have gluten-free wafers if needed.
Power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood.
We're going to sing that again.
Of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood.
Yes, there is.
Of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. Wonder-working power. Wonder-working power. Oh, wonder-working power.
If you're not sure how to open them, just press down on the tab and it'll kind of separate the top layer for the wafer and then the bottom for the juice. If you just hold up the wafer, this is symbolic of God's, Jesus's body that was broken for us. He said he is the bread of life.
Yes.
And we believe that every slash that was taken, every flogging that was beaten on his body was for us.
Yes.
For all our sin, he took it all.
Yes.
We thank you, Jesus, that you are the perfect sacrifice. We thank you, Jesus. Let us receive. The cup that represents the blood of Christ that was poured out on that cross, that became the atoning sacrifice for our sins, that we could be set free, could walk in freedom, be alive and new in Jesus. We thank you, Jesus, for your blood that was poured out on that cross. We thank you for the sacrifice and the victory that you brought. We thank you, Jesus. Let us receive. So while we give God praise, while the worship team continues to play, there is power in the blood. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
In the blood of the Lamb, there is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. honor and praise. We glorify your mighty name. You are wonderful and awesome and holy. You are worthy of all praise. We give you praise and honor, Father, and we thank you. We thank you for this moment right here, Father. You are worthy of everything. In Jesus' name, amen.
The Bible is God's word, the voice of the Creator, a lamp to our feet, a light to our path, a guide in the darkness of life. The Bible is God's word, showing us Jesus, the Word made flesh. He came, died, rose, and will one day return to make all things new. The Bible is God's word, our daily reminder of who we are in Christ, new people with new hearts, ambassadors for his kingdom. The Bible is God's word, the voice we listen for, the truth we cling to, the bread we crave, the wisdom we live by. It is worth our discipline, our attention, our focus, our obedience, our devotion. The Bible. 66 books, one hero, one message. Through Jesus, God is redeeming a sinful people to himself. Know him, love him, hear him. God has spoken.
Honestly, I don't, oh, there we go. I was going to say, I don't even need a mic. It's just for the viewers online. Welcome to Living Word. I feel honored to be here and to see you guys and to be a part of just what God is doing. I mean, he's here, he's moving, and I feel so honored that we not only get an opportunity to be in his house, but that we can gather together and that I'm even allowed to give announcements. I mean, seriously, think about that. Like, we are in God's house. Yes, we can't take these things for granted. Like that said, the Bible, he's already spoken. We're out here searching for all these answers, right? When's he coming back? When's this happening? He's already given us the answers. We won't know, okay? And so just rest in the peace and the hope that he's already given us. Okay, so I am going to do our prayer focus for this morning. Each Sunday, we have a different prayer focus. For those of you who don't know, I'm Pastor Nathaniel's wife. I see some new faces. It's very nice to meet you. And welcome to our viewers online as well. And so our prayer focus this morning is the federal government. So if you guys would just join me in prayer. Thank you, Jesus. You are so holy. Thank you, God, for even allowing me to speak to you, for even listening to us, for answering our prayers. Thank you, God. I come to you with our federal government. God, you know everything, that the ins and the outs of our government. You know the ins and the outs of our world. You know the things that have to take place. But I'm asking, Lord, that you intercede, that you touch President Biden, you encounter him, as well as Vice President Harris, the Senate, the Congress, the Supreme Court, lead and guide their decisions, Lord. We want your will to play out. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We praise you for being in control. We thank you for being our ultimate king and leader. And we can rest and know that you are in control. We praise your holy name. Amen. So if the ushers want to come forward, and as they pass around the little basket, I will be giving you guys the announcements. So, Lord, bless the offering, every single penny that comes in, that you would just direct it, God, and we would use it to meet the needs of your body and your community. Amen. Okay, so announcements. We've only got three. That's not bad. Okay, the first one is we have a potluck and family board game fellowship Sunday, April 21st, after the 10 a.m. service. Bring a dish to share. Bring a board game to share. I'm excited. Hopefully you guys are too. If you, it would be great if you would sign up at the Connection Hub, which is right outside these doors. Sign up. Just say if you're going to bring a side dish, a main dish, or a dessert. That way we don't have all desserts or something. Not that that would be entirely bad, okay? But for those who want, you know, just kind of it being well thought out, we have that there. And bring your favorite board game. I'm excited to see what that is and the variety that we have. Youth Sunday is April 28th during the 10 a.m. service. So make sure you're here. Make sure you bring a friend. The youth are going to take over our service, and it's always a blessing to see what God speaks to our teenagers and to see what God's word has revealed to them. It's always amazing. And then the third announcement is our AC compressor broke. So if it feels hot, yeah. If you would like to donate towards that, then please just write a note that on the check or the envelope that it's for the compressor. And we appreciate that, and we thank you in advance. And now it's the time to greet the people around you, meet somebody new, and just kind of catch up. So go ahead. Do it.
Get back to our seats. All right, all right, all right. Hi. All right. Look, y'all just be like, hey, let's swap phone numbers. We'll talk later, right? At the potluck. There you go. At the potluck. That's gonna be fun. I love board games. I think board games are gonna be exciting. We might see some super competitive nature coming out in some board games. Spoons, hungry, hungry hippo. Huh? Yeah. Scrabble, so we can test people's knowledge of real words or false words. Right? That's not a real word. It doesn't matter. But it gave me 63 points. It's going to be good, though. So my name is Pastor Nathaniel. We just want to say welcome. We are so glad you're here. It is so exciting for y'all to be here. This is a great body of Christ, and we just love all of y'all. So we are in, super excited. We finished Easter, and that was just, I hope y'all really enjoyed the Bread to Cup series. And then Easter sunrise and then Easter service, just I thought was just, Pastor Jim did an amazing job at sunrise, and then I thought Easter went really well. But we are starting a new series. It's actually going to be a longer series than what we typically do. You know, we typically average 3 to 4 weeks. This is going to be much, much longer. And then there's going to be some breaks in between. So don't stress that it's going to be a longer series. But we are doing one. I've been praying about it and just feel that we should do one called the Ark of the Bible. And ARC is short for archaeological. And so we're going to go through the evidence of the Bible. What do y'all think about that? We're going to go through the evidence. Now, if we were to go through all the evidence of the Bible, we would be here until next year. And y'all would probably be exhausted and your brains would hurt because of all the information that would be out there. So we're not going until next year, just to December. I'm just kidding. We're not doing that. But I think we're going to hit on a lot of points, and we're going to provide many stories for you of the archaeological evidence that we have. And there's plenty, plenty more that we're not even going to touch on. So I already know that. So don't come to me and go, well, what about this? I know that. We're just going to go through, and so I'm really excited to show this. We're going to have video clips of things, so you're going to be able to see pictures, even video clips of the places and the sites and all that. So this is for y'all. This is for your benefit. So if you do not believe that the Bible's true, or, you know, is it there? How can it be truth when we have all these other religions and so forth and so on? We're going to go through all of that with the archaeological evidence. Amen? Amen. Well, if you would please turn to 2 Timothy chapter 3. 2 Timothy chapter 3. If you'd please stand as we read the Word of God. So this week and next week are going to be myself forming a, we're going to be forming a foundation to build on for the archaeological evidence, okay? We felt that it would be probably wise to build a solid foundation first before we just started diving into the archaeological evidence. So that's what this week and next week are going to be, is just to build up to that, okay? So 2 Timothy 3, verse 15 and 16. Hopefully all of you are there. And it says, "And how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness." Amen. Let us pray. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your word. Lord, we thank you, Lord, that you have provided such truth, such revelation to our hearts, to our minds. Thank you that what the power brings in the word, that it speaks life. Lord, it breaks through the deception and the lies. We thank you, Jesus, for your word. We ask that you just move in such a mighty way this morning. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. So we're dealing with the Ark of the Bible, and the subtitle's Breathe, because we're really going to focus on 2 Timothy chapter 3 at this moment, and we'll probably stay focused on this for the next 2 weeks before we get into all these really cool, I'm excited. I'm actually really excited. I love doing this kind of study. It's awesome. But I have this quote here by R.C. Sproul, and it says, "It is your duty to believe and to teach what the Bible teaches, not what you want it to teach." Right? And that is such a huge thing right now. We kind of take the scripture because we struggle believing in what authority scripture has. So what we do is we take it, and then I share with it what I feel it should teach to you, not what scripture itself actually teaches. That's not how this works. See, every word has been orchestrated by God for our benefit. Every word. Amen. Every word has been orchestrated by God for your benefit. Now, these are some just basic points that probably many of you know, or maybe you don't know. You know the Bible consists of 66 books, right? There are 39 books in the Old Testament, 27 books in the New Testament, There are 1,189 chapters in the Bible. There are 31,102 verses in the Bible. And there are 40 authors that wrote the Bible over a span of 1,500 years. It's pretty crazy, right? The chapter thing is, you know, if you just read 10 chapters a day, you could read the Bible, I believe, twice a year. Just 10 chapters a day. Isn't that crazy? We struggle reading it once a year. Interesting. A huge question that arises, though, could possibly be even one of the number one questions that are out there is, how is the Bible reliable and trustworthy with so many involved in the writing, right? And I'm sure many of us have even had that question as we've maybe walked or grown up into the church, or even now at this moment you have that question. How in the world can Pastor Nathaniel or Pastor Jim or any other pastor out there at any other church can stand and preach from the Bible? How is it reliable and trustworthy? That's a big question. Well, we are going to attempt to answer that question, but at this moment we're going to have to build a foundation first. I have another quote here by A.W. Tozer, and he says, "The Bible is not an end in itself, but a means to bring men to an intimate and satisfying knowledge of God, that they may enter into him, that they may delight in his presence, may taste and know the inner sweetness of the very God himself in the core and center of their hearts." That's a phenomenal quote. So let's look at 2 Timothy chapter 3, and we're dealing with the breakdown. This is the breakdown. And if you read in, when we read over verse 15, if you don't know, Paul is writing to Timothy, right? Paul brings Timothy into his side to kind of counsel and train him. And Timothy becomes a phenomenal man of God that Paul sends out to really become a preacher, right? And 2 Timothy is actually one of the latter books that is written in the New Testament besides Revelations. So it's one of the latter books. And here, when he addresses in verse 15 of 2 Timothy 3, and he says, "And how from childhood," so he's talking to Timothy and about Timothy, "you have been acquainted with the sacred writings." I was looking at that through the Greek and what the context is of the sacred writings. He's actually discussing what Timothy was raised studying scripture. He was raised as a godly man. And so Paul is addressing Timothy in verse 15 saying, hey, from your childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings. He's saying through childhood you have been acquainted with the Old Testament, through the scriptures that is known. Does that make sense? Okay? And he says, now Paul is stating what these sacred writings are doing. They are able to make you wise for salvation. Amen. Through faith. It doesn't stop there. Through faith, say through faith, in Christ Jesus. That's it, right? Then he comes in, Paul does, and says, hey, Timothy, we know this is where you were. You're acquainted with these Old Testament writings. You're familiar with it. You've been trained in it. You've been doing this. But I want you to be assured, because where I'm sending you, there is really heresy happening, all types of doctrines happening. And he's saying, here, I want you to know this. All scripture. Say all.
All.
You know what that means in the Greek?
All.
Man. We are good, aren't we? All means all. And you know, I do look up the Greek word to make sure that it still means all. And guess what? It still means all. It hasn't changed. So when we meet, and guess what the Hebrew word for all means?
All.
Y'all are some scholars, right? All scripture. Do you know that when Paul was writing 2 Timothy, do you know that he didn't know of all the other books of the New Testament that were written at that time? Do y'all know that, right? He probably maybe have heard or even have come across some of the New Testament books, maybe, right? This is only speculation. So he's really referencing, when he states this, when Paul states this, he's talking about the entire Old Testament, and God's given him revelation that there's going to be more to come probably. And he didn't know that all that was 66 books. God didn't tell him, hey, I want you to write all scripture down because there's going to be 66 books. This is what it's going to look like. No, the Holy Spirit led him and said, this is what you need to put because this is what is needed. And it says, all scripture is breathed out by God, and it is profitable. It's to your benefit. Y'all, the word of God is for your benefit. Some of y'all believe that. I don't know about you, but when I read this and actually dig into it, it's amazing what it does to your life. Why? Because there's life in this. It was breathed out by God, inspired by God. Amen. It's profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for the training in righteousness. I listened to this Greek word about 55 times to be able to pronounce it correctly. But the Greek word here for inspired by God is theopneustos. And that's still probably not correct. But it's theopneustos. And it means inspired by God or God breathed. That's why we have that in Scripture, and depending on your translation. But the word theo, that may look familiar to anybody who has studied the word of God, the word theo actually means God. That's why we get the word theology. It's the study of God, right? Theo means God. The P-N-E-O or P-N-E-U, which is nuo or neo, means breathe. It actually means to instill something into someone. That's what the word means. So when you put those two words together, they add just a little kind of like how we add, run versus running. We add this the N suffix there, I-N-G. The S-T-O-S is just an ending suffix. Does that make sense? So you get neophneustos. And it means God breathed. God actually instilled something into people to write down. So it wasn't just a thought that they popped in their mind and they go, this sounds like a great idea. Okay? All scripture is breathed out by God. See, God instilled the words into the authors to write. God did that. The authors didn't write words because they saw something. They wrote words because it was instilled in them by God. Amen. Y'all got to get a clear understanding of this. I love this example that I came across through my studies. I wanted to take 40 people to the library. So 40 of us here, we're going to go to the library, okay? And I'm going to tell all of you to choose any books that you want. We're all speaking the same language, by the way. Some of the 40 people must choose more than one book, right? Because in order to get 66 books. Everybody with me? What are the odds that all 66 books that were be chosen by these 40 people in this audience would be in agreement and would form one continuous story? It would actually be statistically impossible. Do you know that? The likelihood of even 40 people choosing the same genre would be astronomically impossible. See, the 66 books of the Bible were written by 40 authors, right? From diverse backgrounds. And what that means is what? We know Peter was a what? He was a fisherman. Paul was a tent maker. Matthew was a tax collector. Moses was just the man. You know what I mean? He was just the man, right? But you had this diverse background of people over a span of 1,500 years. And yet, when we bring all 66 books are brought together, they form one complete, unified story from beginning to end. What are the odds of that happening? Do you know that if God did not exist, do you know that the possibility of a book actually even coming close and formed 66 books to be a unified story would never exist? Because here's the thing. Let's just say God doesn't exist. We said that in church, I know. Let's just take him out of the picture for a moment. Just take him out of the picture and join me for this imaginary story here, right? Imagine we take him out of the picture. Do you really think that 40 authors would write something in unison? No. What would happen? I would give my opinion what I thought was right. And they would give their opinion of what they thought was right. And I would say, these are what really moral standards should be. And they would go, well, these are what moral standards should be. And then next, what would we have? Contradictions, issues, and ununified story, wouldn't we? So then how in the world did we get 66 books unified? Well, then there has to be some evidence of supernatural power to bring this involved into one book, wouldn't it? So then I guess God does exist. See, whenever Paul spoke of Scripture, he never had to distinguish it from other writings. Paul always referred to Scripture as the Word of God. Actually, in most places where Paul mentioned it, the words the Scripture says or God says, he's actually bringing equivalence to the Word of God. Okay? Romans chapter 4. Verse 3, for what does the Scripture say? Abraham believed God and it was counted to him as righteousness. Right? That's Romans 4:3. Paul is referencing Scripture. And when he's saying, what does Scripture say? He's actually saying, what does the Word of God say? That's the equivalent of what Paul's referencing when he states these things. Has everybody got that? You can look to 9:17. I think I forgot a colon there. 9:17. For the Scripture says to Pharaoh, Paul again stating this, for this very purpose I have raised you up, that I might show my power in you and that my name might be proclaimed in all the earth, right? Actually, you have Romans 11 too. Look at Galatians. Let's look at Galatians chapter 3. Chapter 3, verse 8, it says, and the Scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, and for this, and the Scripture. So anytime Paul is referencing the Scripture says, God says, this is what it's stating. The equivalence of this is, he's saying, the Word of God is saying this. It's not by Paul's authority. Y'all got that? It's by God's authority. And then, of course, we can look at 1 Timothy real quick. 5:18. And it says, For the Scripture says. And then he goes on, you shall outmuzzle an oxen. And he clears therefore. So, in most places, see, Paul mentions these words, and the Scripture says they're equivalent of what God says. And if you actually want to turn to, I want to read this a couple of these scriptures. If you turn back to Romans chapter 15, just real quick. Romans chapter 15. So we read 2 Timothy 3, right, 15 and 16. It says, all Scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training us in righteousness. Romans 15:4 says, for whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction. Say our instruction. Got it? That through endurance and through the encouragement of the Scriptures, we might have hope. Yeah. Who wants hope? Yeah, we all want hope. Nobody wants no hope. Everybody wants hope. Well, then it says that we should be reading this and studying this because this was written for us. For encouragement, yes. So that we could have hope. Amen. You're lacking in a little bit of hope, you're probably lacking in a little bit of reading. Yes. Second Peter. Chapter 1. Second Peter chapter 1, verse 20. Knowing this, first of all, that no prophecy of Scripture, say no prophecy, of Scripture comes from someone's own interpretation. So do you understand what Peter's starting to state here? And he's addressing another issue to believers. Because why? There's a doubt in the Bible. People are doubting what the Word says. They're questioning it. There's no way that it could be truthful. And you know, that's what was happening back then. This is nothing new, by the way, right?
Amen.
And Peter is saying, knowing this, first of all, that no prophecy of Scripture comes from someone's own interpretation. You know what he's saying? These 40 authors that wrote the Bible did not come from their own interpretation. They didn't sit down and just write down what they thought that was good. They didn't do any of that. It says, 21, for no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. Oh, that's good stuff there.
Amen.
The word of God is breathed, inspired by God. So I want to look at just some points here. Actually, I don't remember. I did so much research, I forget how many points there were. 8 points? That doesn't matter. All right. You're going to hear them anyways. So there's many points that prove that of the consistency of the word of God, right? So point one would be internal consistency. Internal consistency. See, from Genesis to Revelations, there is a consistency through Scripture. God is the supreme being. He created man. Man sinned. God makes a way to restore us.
Amen.
That's the story.
Yeah.
Really summed up, paraphrased pretty quickly, right?
Amen.
You know what's amazing is all churches and all believers agree to this statement. It's when we start defining the in-between statements. Do you know that 40 authors over the course of 1,500 years, it took 40 people, if I took 40 people right now and asked them, just right now, from 40 of you right here, who believes in Jesus Christ and that they're saved? Right? Okay, so all of us believe that Jesus is saved. Praise God. Honestly, praise God. Okay? Because I ain't saving you. There's only one person that is, okay? But if I took 40 of you right now, 40 believers, and I asked you to write down your views of God, what's wrong in the world, and how it could be made right, do you know that all 40 of you would not agree?
Yeah.
Think about that. The only thing you would agree on would be Jesus, but the methodology and how it's performed would be a disagreed unison. There'd be no agreement amongst 40 of you, and we're all believers in Christ. Now, y'all got that picture, correct? So how in the world did we get 40 authors writing a unified story in the span of 1,500 years? I bet if we play telephone right now. Right? And I whispered in Ed's ear. And Ed went to 40 other people. Man, it'd be, who knows what the story would be by then, wouldn't it? And guess what? Here's the crazy part. We all speak the same language. Do you know that when the word of God was written through the 40 authors, it was written by different languages. And somehow we came up with a unified story. Just coincidence, I guess. The next point is manuscript reliability. If you don't know, I'm building a foundation. So I know there is a ton more, and we're going to dig into a lot more, okay? So just bear with the foundation building here. Over 5,000 full or partial manuscripts of the Greek New Testament and more over found every year. That's how many manuscripts we have of the New Testament, 5,000.
Amen.
Got that? Now, if the Bible was at any point had any, I'm sure many of y'all heard this through TikTok, because clearly TikTok is the theology place to go. Right? And so, but I'm sure that you have heard that there is contradictions in the Bible. Has anybody heard that? Yeah?
Yeah.
Right. We hear them. The Bible contradicts itself. It contradicts itself. So let's just place, I want you all to think. We got to do some logical thinking, all right? If the Bible contradicts itself, then that would mean that every evidence that has been found from 1942 to 2024, all the archaeological sites, all the manuscripts, all the stones written in writing with names, if there was a contradiction in the Bible, those would begin to make the contradiction stand out because there would be inconsistency.
Yeah.
correct? Do you know that every manuscript that has been found, every archaeological site that has been found, and every stone, every slab, everything you want to call, whatever it is, all backs up and verifies the validity of Scripture? There's no way. There's absolutely no way. But God. Man, there would be no, I'm going to tell you what, there's no way man can do it. It's not possible. So we have just the New Testament, over 5,000 full or partial manuscripts of the Greek New Testament. And of course, we find more every year. We find more evidence every year, but it doesn't cause revisions or major changes to Scripture. All that it tends to happen is a minor variation of a specific word. And what, just as an example, right, God breathed. We're looking at all Scriptures God breathed. They might pull up a manuscript of Timothy, and they'll look at the Greek word, and they'll go, it might not say God breathed, but it says God inspired. Well, it's really the same thing. It's just said differently, right? These are the variations that they're finding. Does that call issue with Scripture? Okay. You know, not part of the Bible came as any person's individual or personal interpretation or explanation. No writer of Scripture sat down to figure out what would be good, proper, or correct to say. Do you know that? For the prophecy, the speaking for God, came not in old time by the will or desire of man, but was holy. Meant of God, he spoke as they were moved and led by the Holy Spirit. The next point for proof of the Bible is historical evidence. Bible has been proven historically, geographically, and archaeologically accurate. See, one archaeologist said, it may be stated categorically that no archaeological discovery has ever controverted a biblical reference, ever. Amen. Think about that. Some of the videos and studies we do on archaeology, they actually, secular archaeologists that say they don't even believe there is a God, so these are atheist archaeologists, still state that the Bible is one of the most accurately archaeological sources to this day. Wow. And you want to go, but there's no God? If that's proof, 2,500 years ago, then wouldn't Jesus be proof? 2,000 years ago? The next point is fulfilled prophecy. You've heard me state this multiple times, and even last Sunday when we spoke on Easter of dealing with the fulfillments of Jesus. There's 300 specific prophecies from the Old Testament dealing with Jesus, and they were completely fulfilled. I want you to think about that. Do you know there is no other book in the world that has any person that has fulfilled any kind of prophecy like that? You know what we get, you know what I'm sure you've seen in the videos and the YouTube and the TikTok and the social media and all that's out there. We see the false prophet, we see prophets arise and the Lord told me and they say these things, right? Trump was supposed to be in office. You know, you've heard all that, you know, and then we're dealing with the solar eclipse. We're dealing with all this stuff, right? You're seeing these prophets. But what are we seeing? A lot of them aren't coming true, are they? Right? And we're just talking day to day. Present time. Y'all with me?
Yes.
Okay, so if we're seeing inconsistencies in that, we should be like, man, there's, you know, we should start scratching our head a little bit when it comes to prophecies over these things, right? But then there's prophecies in the Old Testament that are 1,000 years before they were fulfilled. And have been fulfilled. And proven fulfillment. It's incredible. R.C. Sproul says, the very dimension of the sheer fulfillment of the prophecy of the Old Testament Scripture should be enough to convince anyone that we are dealing with a supernatural piece of literature.
Amen.
That's a good quote there. I like me a little R.C. Sproul. There's eyewitness testimony, 2 Peter. 2 Peter. Chapter 1, verse 16. Everybody there? For we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. So again, Peter is addressing believers. And see, what is being the statement that's, we're seeing it again. This is nothing new, by the way, okay? But we're seeing it, we're starting to see it, and everything's a little bit more in your face because of social media. And he's addressing, he's saying, look, this isn't a myth that some man raised from the dead and died for your sins. It's not a myth. You want to know why it's not a myth? Because the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty, Jesus Christ's majesty. The disciples saw Jesus, not only before his death, but even after, when he rose from the grave. Amen. Jesus actually presented himself to over 500 people before he ascended. Do you know, I don't know if you've heard The Case of Christ by Lee Strobel. Has anybody heard that? Yeah? If you have not watched The Case for Christ by Lee Strobel, watch it and read the book. I strongly encourage you to do so. But I love what they say is Lee Strobel goes to a, I believe it's a professor of psychology, and he goes, what are the odds? He goes, couldn't you say that all these disciples and all 500 of these people had a hallucination? Do you know that what she said? She said, for 500 people to have a hallucination of Jesus is a greater miracle than Jesus actually rising from the dead. Sometimes we try so hard not to believe, but it's that simple. Amen. Timeless authority. Century after century after century, the Bible has shown itself to be our judge. Its authority has been attacked, questioned, criticized, disputed, and denied in every age. Yet it still remains. Amen. This is nothing new. Again, where people come, this is, you know, and they try to attack and disprove. This has been from the beginning. And it still holds true, still accurate, still alive. This is why we stand on the stage and we preach from the Word of God. Because if you want change in your life, Jesus will do it, and so will the Word of God. Because he, if he breathed in this, he's going to breathe into you. He's going to give life and conviction. And he's going to give encouragement and hope. And you're like, how is this possible? Read the Word of God. Yes. Yeah, but you don't see, I want to hear God speak. Read the Word of God. Amen. He spoke over 1,500 years. He's still speaking today. Yes. Read the Word of God. The problem that we have with this is that because it speaks so much life, it has actually so much conviction in it and truth in it, we don't want that. We want Jesus to pat us on the back as we still live in sin. I want all the goodness of God, but I don't want the correction of God. And in Scripture it says, he corrects those he loves. Yes, yeah, he died on the cross for you, but if you're going to want to live for him, he's going to bring some correction. Yes. He's going to shape and mold you. He's going to make you a better you. Yes. You can't make you a better you. I know society says that, you know, exercise, eat healthy, do all this. It ain't happening. Donuts taste so good. It ain't happening. You know what I'm saying? Everybody's like, yeah, that's right. Cheesecake, boy, caramel, you know? Woo! Okay. You can't make you a better you. Only God can. Amen. We can do all we want to change our physical appearance, to make ourselves feel better, but emotionally and mentally and spiritually we're dead. It doesn't matter what you look like on the outside. Yeah. You're going to sit at home depressed. Yep, that's right. Going, I got the body of, you know, this supermodel, but really deep down I'm dead. That's right. I'm hopeless. I can't do anything about it. It doesn't matter. Amen. See, God doesn't put in here what you have to look like. He puts in here what you got to believe, trust, and act like. Mm. I forgot which point we're on. Supernatural authenticity. The scripture was breathed and inspired by God, which we read in 2 Timothy, right? So it's supernatural. So this book was supernaturally made. See, in every place where the Bible has been, it has supernaturally changed lives because of the truth. See, God moves powerfully over those who read and believe in his word. See, you can't just believe in Jesus and then not live by the standards that he has written. You got to live by this as well. This is an instruction manual. To say, okay, God, I believe in you. You saved me from my sin, and you've changed my life. I'm a new creation, but now what does that look like? Amen. Right here. Amen. How do you overcome depression? It's right here. Amen. How do you know what truth looks like? It's right here. You want to be wiser in your job? You want to be wiser at home? You want to be a better father, husband, wife? It's right here. And then finally, the last quote here is, oh, that's joined to two things. I forgot to space that out, I'm sorry. But the latter part of that where it says the Bible redirects is the quote from Stanley Jones. It says, the Bible redirects my will. It cleanses my emotions. It enlightens my mind. And it quickens my total being. See, Jesus is alive. He has saved us from our sin, and he didn't, you know what I love about Jesus? He didn't leave us defenseless. He didn't leave us hopeless. He didn't leave us without weapons and tools to strengthen our spirit, our soul, our mind, and our heart. He didn't leave us and just goes, good luck, guys, I saved you. He says, you know what? I know what they need. Not only do they need me, they need guidance and wisdom and truth and conviction. They need my spirit to be poured out on you so that you can walk in might and boldness. You need the armor of God. Amen. What is the armor of God? It's in the Word of God. Amen. Read it. It's there, right? So you want to change your life? I'd start with Jesus. Then I'd start with the Word of God. We get in this mindset, and I've seen it, and you know, I've even done it, so that's why I know I can speak to this, but we get in this mindset that like we're too scared to open this up because it's confusing, so we open up side books, hoping to get life out of that instead of the Bible. Amen. The problem is that if we don't know this, those side books will taint your view of God. And now we have all types of doctrines because we've looked at side books to help determine what Jesus has said instead of actually looking at what Jesus said. The Word of God is inspired and it's authoritative. So if you please stand. Yes, please. Thank you. It's 95 in here, and then it's with the lights, it's about 110, and then with the blazer, it feels 135. So, Lord, fix the AC, right? Before it gets 100 degrees outside. Amen. Yeah. God is good, though. What I love, though, is, you know, I'm excited about this because I believe that this is going to strengthen and encourage a lot of you and really uplift your faith to know that this is a reliable book to trust in. Because here's the thing, if this is so reliable, then wouldn't that be a testament of how reliable Jesus is? Right? Because if this contradicts itself, then Jesus contradicts himself. So then we're following the wrong God. But this holds true and has held true for millenniums. And still, it still is. And it's amazing. It's still current and present for today. So then that means that Jesus is still present for today. It means he's still current in your life. It means he can still change the circumstances that you're in. He can still provide in the circumstances you're in, because that's what he did with the word. Yes. We need to have a greater hunger for God. Yes. We need to have a greater hunger for his word. Yes. Really, we need to, honestly, in this time of age and day and age, and Lord knows what's going to happen with the solar eclipse tomorrow. So, you know, you might want to get down on your knees and read a little bit. Start with John, chapter 1. But I feel like, though, we really need to humbly present ourselves. We shouldn't just grab this and read it because, you know, Pastor Nathaniel said that's something I should do. I grab this and read this because I go, Lord, what are you going to share with me? What are you going to change in me? What are you going to convict in me to make me a better me? Lord, we need to start looking more like Christ. Yes. Everybody, we all know, we agree to that. There's only one way to do it. Surrender to Jesus and surrender to what he has written. Yes. The commands, the standards, the policies that he's got in here. And it's all for your profit. All for your good. So I want us to pray. I'm going to just pray. And really, I just think we should just present ourselves. And what I mean by that is that you can just stand there, but just feel like you're opening your heart to God. God, forgive us. Lord, forgive us for not taking your word seriously. Lord, forgive us for not taking you seriously. Lord, have mercy on us. Lord, I thank you for everything you have done, but continue to pour out a greater hunger for you, a greater hunger for your word. Lord, that we no longer see the Bible as this bondage and like this hindrance to our lives, but we see it as life that will breathe into us hope, joy, truth. Thank you, God, for your word. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, that you have forgiven us for our sins. Thank you that you forgave me. Thank you that in the times that I feel weak, that I fall and stumble, God, I know that you are faithful. If I just turn to you, you pick me back up. I thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. There is no one like you. We give you praise, Jesus. Holy are you. Worthy are you. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I pray that you pour out a hunger for you and a hunger for your word. In the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, break through the lies, the deception, the doubt, the unbelief in the name of Jesus. But that you pour out new life. Strengthen your people. Encourage them. In Jesus' name we pray. And all people say, amen. Amen. God bless you. Yes. Yes. Don't forget to fall in love with the author of the word. Because he is the reason. He's the reason for it all. This would be nothing without him. How amazing that is. How amazing that is. He saved us with a mighty hand. A mighty hand. He saved us. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. I'm sure that was probably new to some people, but it's a spiritual song that really lines up to what we preached on, what Butch just said. God is not a man. He is faithful. Amen. He will see us through. In the times to come, he will see us through. Yes? God is good. God bless you all. I pray that the Lord just be with you throughout your day. Thank you so much.